Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you might be. Personally, I'm sitting at the airport in Stockholm, so I apologize if the internet should be a little lousy, but so far, so good. But more importantly, I got Shane here with me today. And Shane, first and foremost, thank you so much, my friend, for being here. I appreciate you taking out the time. As some of you may know, I am releasing a new book in about a month from McGraw Hill. And we have agreed, the publisher and I, that we would invite some really important people to really host this show, because I'm not the host, Shane is, and really just have a chat with me, laid-back chat about the book, the world, the concept, negotiation, and whatever Shane feels like. So Shane and I haven't prepared anything, so I am excited. So what's going to happen? But again, Shane, I want to appreciate, thank you so much, my friend, for taking the time. I really love everything you're doing in the world of negotiation and your mission to promote negotiation. But if anybody, and I doubt it, but if anybody shouldn't know you, Shane, could you just add a few words about yourself?
Yeah, sure. And, you know, two congratulations are in order, Keld. One to you for the book coming out in a month, and also two for the listener for being here to learn about negotiation. That's the first step to getting better. And as you said, my name is Shane. If we haven't met, I'm the founder of Mediation Table and also the host of Deal Talk, where we put out episodes of people talking about negotiation every single week. It's incredible, brilliant people. So I'm honored to be able to interview Tip.
Yeah, it's going to be fun. What do you want to talk about, Shane?
All right, excellent. Well, first, let me introduce you first. And that way I'll set the stage and then I'll share what we're going to get into. So I have prepared a few things. So don't fret. We are prepared. We are ready to rock and roll. Keld has done so many of these interviews. He's been on stages all over the world. So this is going to be a breeze for him. I'll try to stump him on a couple of questions, but it's highly unlikely that will happen today. So Keld has written 24 books, which is an astonishing accomplishment in itself, and they've been published in 36 plus countries. So quite an accomplished author. And also he's the CEO of the Center for Negotiation. So they do consulting, they do training. I've even been able to sit in one of the trainings in Lithuania for 2 days, and it was a fantastic experience, and it ended with an actual negotiation simulation. So it's not just theory that we're going to be talking about today. We're also going to be talking about practicality as well. And so Keld has worked with Lego, Rolls-Royce, Maersk, the biggest shipping company in the world. So Keld is very experienced. He's a professor, author, speaker. If you haven't connected with him already, make sure to do so on LinkedIn. So Keld, you're famous for saying not enough people have negotiation strategies. The first question I want to start with today is, why is having a negotiation strategy critical?
Wonderful question, Shane. And it's one of my favorite topics because I was actually just sitting with a client here in Stockholm yesterday, a major manufacturing company in retail as well, thousands of employees throughout the world. And I was sitting with the COO and the CEO, and I asked them this question, as I often do when I'm working with a new client. It is, could a PC or official negotiation client? And I'm asking this question normally expecting no answer, and I didn't get any answer either this time. They were just quiet and said, we don't have one. And then I just start teasing even more by saying, okay, could I see your sales strategy? They got that. Could I see your communication strategy? They got that. Could I see your go-to-market strategy? They got that. Could I see your research and development strategy? They got that. But they don't have a negotiation strategy. And to me, it is essential. Obviously, I'm living and breathing negotiation. But we have to remember one thing. Negotiation is the time and the place where value are being created and distributed every time we have commercial negotiations. So negotiation is a leadership strategy. So not having a strategy is in negotiation. It's the same as not having a strategy for sales, for management, for HR, for all the other stuff. And everything else we know we need a strategy around. So I'm not just talking strategy because I'm in it. I'm talking a strategy because I know, based on studies, and we're talking about this in my new book, based on studies of more than 35,000 negotiators, we know that organizations and individuals who have a defined strategy are way more successful than those organizations and individuals that don't have one. So in the book, we're going to discuss what is a strategy, because obviously I can't tell you, Shane, anybody else, what is the right strategy for you. You have to create your own. But at least the first step is we have to acknowledge and understand we need a negotiation strategy.
Of course. It's equated to going on a road trip without a map. You have a destination in mind of where you want to get to. And if you don't have a plan or a way to get there, you may spend years getting to where you want to go when actually it could only take hours. And so Mediation Essentials comes out October 24th, which is quite exciting. In the book, you have sort of broken down into four specific parts. There are great chapters. There are many different topics covered, but there are four things that really stood out to me when I was reviewing it. You said one, that you need a strategy, which we just discussed that and the importance of that. Two, you said trust. You got to have trust. Three, you talk about the rules of the game. So negotiating the negotiation. And then four, you talk about nego economics and how to engineer value. So let's talk about trust. You have spoken on trust. Trust, I feel like, is it's your bread and butter. It's your specialty. Like a doctor has a specialty, trust, I feel like, is your specialty. Tell us about trust and how we can build it in our next negotiation.
Yeah, it is close to my heart for the simple reason that it makes sense. Trust is essential. And I think everybody watching and listening could probably sit there and nod and say, yes, I do understand trust is important. It becomes complicated when we actually have to implement and utilize trust. The reason I'm talking a lot about trust is because it has a financial impact. It's actually a variable we can monetize. So I'm not only talking about trust because it's a nice human thing. I'm also talking about it because those who can actually create trust are financially more successful in negotiations. And it's actually pretty simple, Shane. You know, the higher level of trust we have, the more we actually reduce our transactional cost in any kind of collaboration, and the more we improve our profit. And I would also say something else. Trust is connected to the other term that you just mentioned, negoeconomics. And negoeconomics is an award-winning mathematical model I created, which basically just stands for negotiation economics, which perhaps we're going to talk about it. But it's a very simple mathematical model that just have identified there's an unrealized value of up to 42% typically between two parties negotiating. So they're leaving that value on the table. Just stepping back to trust. In order to create and realize that value, you need transparency, you need honesty, you need openness, and you need trust, obviously. So if you don't have trust, you can't really step beyond and above the zero-sum positional negotiation game. And Shane, I think you would agree with me that a lot of commercial negotiations are still happening in a positional oriented negotiation, right? You know, I'm winning at your expense or you're winning at my expense. And my mission in life, I don't want it to sound very, very, very religious, but it is actually a mission of mine, is to try and change our mindset on how we perceive negotiation, because it can be so much more than just this zero-sum game.
Yeah, it's true. It's almost like redefining it. And in the book, you did a study of 3,000 people. What were the results of this study based on trust? I think people will find it really interesting.
Yeah, with the 3,000 people we talked to was really about how you put a value on trust. And you know, when I probably did it in the workshop where you attended as well, Shane. The way I do it is I typically take a very simple product, often a glass or whatever I have, a bottle of water, and then I invite one of the people attending the workshop or the presentation, and I ask them, imagine for a second that you're a procurement officer and a bottle of water from this supplier, and you're very happy with this supplier, you're very happy with this bottle of water, you had a long relationship for 6 years, and everything is going smooth, and this supplier you have is fulfilling everything he or she is promising. But then you're getting a new supplier on the market. And then I pick up the same bottle of water, just another one, and I say, and the new supplier is offering the exact same product, same quality, same consistency, same everything. But this new supplier, you don't really like or trust. So you get this gut sensation. There's something, you can't put your finger on it, but you don't really love, like or trust this new supplier. However, your challenge is that this new supplier is 1% cheaper on the exact same product. Who do you want to continue doing business with? Now, some of our listeners today might be surprised, Shane, but I can promise you that 99.9% of everybody I have put in front of this experiment in the last 10 years have been saying the existing one. I would be happy paying 1% more from the one I like and trust. Then I increase the price difference, saying, what if it's 3%, 5%, 7%, 8%, 9%, 10%? And then you see people start dropping off saying, oh, okay, if it's 10% price difference, I would go with the new one, even though I don't like them and trust them. And my point of doing this small kind of stupid exercise is just showing to people trust has a monetary value, because we have just proven that we are willing and able to pay 7, 8, 9, 10% more from a very simple product, just based on the fact that we like that person, we trust that person, and we want to collaborate with that person. So yeah, we did that study with a lot of people and put that study in the book as well. And the funny thing is, Shane, that when I talk to people who are a little bit different than you and I, perhaps not so focused on the human interaction, but more focused on the spreadsheet and the numbers, when I tell them the trust is a monetary value, they look at me like I just arrived from a different planet and saying, you're crazy. And then I do this study, and then we go back to the spreadsheet, insert a line and write trust, because now we can suddenly put a value on it.
Yeah. Well, for how many books you've published, you might be from another planet of just how much content you put out there. I mean, most people struggle to get a couple books. You've done 24. It's so interesting. Trust is a currency. Trust is a currency. I feel like I need to write that down and put a sticky note on the wall and remember that in negotiations when I'm coaching or in actual negotiations myself. You know, I've just found, especially when I've been negotiating against big companies like Microsoft, et cetera, for like tech partnerships, it's hard because the pressure is high. There's so much stress. You know, you have a quota, you have a boss who's you're meeting with every week who's putting this pressure on you. And then to build trust, it's almost like, well, I'm going to put that at the bottom of the list because I need to get a deal. And I think that this book is interesting because you're actually saying flip the script. You're saying start with trust, start small, and then build from there. And in the book is really cool, guys. You got to go pick up the book. There's graphics. I'm very visual. So it resonates when there's content or something, a new insight, and then graphics to support it. It really connects. And you talk about generosity, which I haven't seen a lot of negotiation books necessarily specifically cover. And generosity, essentially, well, I'll let you define it. What is generosity is the first question. And then the second question is, if I'm negotiating with a supplier, I'm negotiating with a boss right now, or negotiating salary, what is something I can be generous with in order to build trust?
That's an excellent question, Shane. First and foremost, I would say, just back to what you said, I'm getting back to trying to answer your question in a second. But it's true. I like to flip it and say we should start with trust, because I normally use the quote that all business is human. I mean, it's Shane and Kel that are talking to each other right now. It's not Microsoft, as Shane was from Microsoft, and me being from my company. It's two individuals. So all business is human, first and foremost. Secondly, what I want to say about trust and what I want to talk about trust is that I think trust should be on the agenda for any meeting. So before Shane and I start any meeting, any negotiation, we should agree on the agenda and the variables and what we need to talk about and the purpose of the meeting, but also trust. So I often tell my students and clients, put trust on the agenda. And I meet some resistance on that, Shane, where people come to me and say, you know, we can't do that. That's weird. I mean, that's almost like a taboo thing. We can't verbalize trust. And I say, why not? I mean, why can't we talk about trust? We could, for instance, talk about it, Shane, and saying, you know, if trust actually drops, if you suddenly feel less trust in me, let's agree that you're going to tell me that. And the same thing the other way around, because that's the only way we can really be honest and open and transparent to each other, by sharing stuff like that. Because it's back to what I said, trust is really financially essential. So that's a crucial part, a very important part about the whole thing. Generosity. There's actually a very famous American, Adam Grant, I believe his name is. He's actually in behavioral psychology. And he have done a lot of serious study and research within generosity. And one of the provoking conclusions he came to is that generous people, givers, are more intelligent than takers. I repeat that. Giving people, generous people, are more intelligent than takers. And what he also concluded was that generous people, givers, are financially more successful than takers. And this is not just something that he claimed. It's actually based on research. It's actually based on serious work. And I have really swallowed everything he's been talking about it. And he's been studying this very carefully. Because it's so essential that we understand that negotiation is not about winning at the expense of the counterpart. The reason that you hopefully join a workshop in negotiation, you listen to Shane, you listen to me, you listen to other experts in the world, you read a book on negotiation. Hopefully you do it so you become more successful in negotiation, because that's why we do it, right? But the important thing here, and I really want to emphasize that, the important thing is that you don't have to be more successful in negotiation at the expense of the counterpart. You can actually seriously, and this is, it's not just theory, you can actually increase success for yourself while at the same time helping the counterpart. So what I'm preaching, Shane, is actually you should open negotiation, and I know some people would probably fall down the chairs right now, but you should open negotiation by saying the following. Shane, I'm here today to help you reduce your costs, reduce your liabilities, and reduce everything that might be negative for you, and at the same time help you improve your profit. Would you be interested in me helping you doing that? Now, when you do that in real life, you might have a counterpart that is sitting there looking suspicious, but they will say yes, because obviously that's what they want. And when they have agreed to that, then you take the next step and say, okay, so we have agreed on that. I'm happy to help you reducing your negative and improving your positive. Having agreed on that, then I also expect you to help me reduce my costs, reduce my liabilities and my negative variables, and help me improve my profit. So that's my expectation from you. So, and the reason and that the way we can do that is obviously focusing on that necroeconomic thing, the asymmetric value. So if I take on a cost that is lower than your benefit, why shouldn't I take on that cost if your benefit is higher and you are happy to compensate for my cost and the other way around? So generosity is really essential, Shane, to be successful in a collaborative negotiation.
Yeah, I find being generous actually magnetizes you. The more that you give strategically, of course, in a negotiation, we're not saying show all your cards and give away every single detail in the very first minute of the negotiation. I don't think that's what you're saying. I think that you're saying strategically build trust by offering opportunities to connect, to build bridges, to minimize arguments and increase collaboration. This is, I feel like, what you're really getting at. And one of the biggest takeaways I had when I was in Lithuania with you and all the wonderful people there in the training was this idea of control and leading the conversation. And I was so happy to see that the book talks about not allowing the other party to essentially drag you and pull you around everywhere. And maybe you felt that way. If you've been in a negotiation, you feel like you can't get the upper hand. I know I've been there. And so tell us about why it's important to control and lead the conversation rather than follow.
Well, I would say in general, it's important to know if you are behind on points or you're about to lose a negotiation. If you are meeting a very skilled, what I would call a very skilled manipulating negotiator, a very skilled manipulated negotiator could be very friendly and seem very collaborative, but there might be a hidden agenda where they're controlling the game. Back to the concept of smartnership. Smartnership is basically partnership version 2.0. So it's a developed version of collaborations where trust is one thing and the concept of necroeconomics is another. And you might find in reality, if you buy and read the book or believe in any of my philosophies, that you might, and try it out in reality, you might find that the counterpart agrees with everything. But at the end of the day, you're sitting there losing. And that's because the counterpart might be in reality running a zero-sum game and you're running a 100% collaborative game. And if that's the case, you're going to lose. So if you're open, transparent, sharing data, and the counterpart is only pretending, the counterpart is gathering all that information. So it's a very important point you're raising right now, Shane, because it's really important to know, am I about to lose this negotiation? And you may not realize that during negotiations. You might be sitting there thinking, this is going great. You know, counterpart is great. I'm great. We're sharing information, or at least I think we're sharing information. But in reality, it's you that is giving everything away. So I absolutely love what you said before, Shane. It's not about giving everything away. You still have to be tactical. It's all about timing. It's all about something for something. I'm willing to share some of my information, Shane, if you share some of your information, because being concessional in negotiation is deadly. So it's true. There's a chapter that is basically just focused on you being able to realize that you're about to lose this negotiation and what you can do it to turn that around.
Yeah, it's so interesting. That was a huge light bulb moment in life, is especially in specifically in negotiations. If you notice that you're continually to pour out and give to the other party, you got to ask yourself, what am I getting in return? What am I getting back? Because if you don't respect yourself or respect your position in the negotiation, you can't expect the other person to respect you. So it starts with you. With you first. So we've talked about a quick room refresh. So we've talked about why having a negotiation strategy is important. It is your guide. It is crucial in order to deliver exceptional results. So we touched on that. The second thing we talked about is how you can build trust, why you need trust, and how Keld has mentioned that trust is a currency. And we also talked through a study that supports that as well. The third thing now we want to get to is this interesting concept that I didn't know until I read your content and learned about you and read your books and attended your training, is talking about the rules of the game, negotiating the negotiation. I want to cover that. And then I also want to cover how to engineer value after that. And then I also want to get into Keld Jensen as the man, as the negotiator, to wrap up today's show. So rules of the game, negotiate the negotiation. What does that sound like and when should it happen?
I know it sounds weird. I have to be the first one to admit that, but we often have to negotiate how to negotiate, because we perceive negotiation differently. I'm normally saying that, you know, United Nations in New York has never declared an international standard for negotiation. You know, this is the way we have to negotiate. So that means that Shane might be negotiating differently than I am, and Paul might be negotiating differently than Shane and I, and Maria might be negotiating that in a very different way than all of us. So we arrive at the negotiation table perceiving negotiation differently. Paul might be seeing negotiation as tennis, and I might perceive negotiation as chess. So it's going to be a ridiculous game, isn't it? If Paul's playing tennis and I'm playing chess, you know, you can just imagine that picture in front of you. And we have to realize that's the way it is. So what I have realized is that we actually need not only to talk about trust, but we also need to talk about how we're going to negotiate today. I mean, are we playing tennis? Are we playing chess? Are we going to be in a very positional negotiation? Are we going to be collaborative? Are we going to share values and cost? Are we going to be transparent? Or perhaps we're not. But we need to realize that. So in major negotiation, more important negotiation, I always advise clients and students to have a pre-meeting prior to the actual negotiation with the single purpose of just discussing how we're going to negotiate on Thursday next week. And people might be thinking, well, this takes time. It does. But all that time you invest in that opening part, I can promise you one thing, you're going to save that down the road, because you're going to save a lot of misunderstanding and confusions and what have you. So back to the agenda. And I'm talking about agenda several times, because agenda is really essential in order to keep a structure in a negotiation. So in an agenda, I often insist that we have obviously welcome, happy to see you, who's who, whatever. And then another point right after that should be rules of the game. How are we going to negotiate today? And then we have an actual discussion on how we're going to do that, because it's really essential, as I said, that we know we are playing the same game. And if we're not doing that, I'm sure you've experienced the same thing, Shane. It takes time to get on the same court. It takes time to figure out what is it we're about to do. So I strongly recommend that, and talk about that in the book as well, how we should do that.
Yeah, it's, you know, it's good. And, you know, practically as well, even adding on to that too, Keld, is how that sounds in a negotiation can be super simple. You just say, you know, like you said, add it to the agenda so it's not surprising to the other party or to who you're negotiating with, if you can. But you can also change out. It doesn't necessarily have to be rules of the game. It can just be something about, you know, conversation about the conversation, you know, or something like that. And it just simply, I mean, how I've done it is I've just said, hey, you know, before we get into things, I'd really like to just sit down and have a conversation about how we want things to go today. First, one thing, if you need to take a break, just let me know. That's totally fine. Second, I operate very transparently. And so everything I say today, I'm going to say the truth. I'm going to say the truth. And if I don't know, I'm going to tell you that I don't know. Is that something that you can agree to today as well? I've done things like that. And every single time they say, yeah, of course, you know, we want to negotiate like that too. Because you have to remember that the other party is at the table for a reason. I think that this is a big thing that I'm seeing out in the marketplace, helping a lot of executives right now negotiate their salaries, is they underestimate their power in the negotiation. They underestimate their ability to actually land a really amazing salary. And so if you're feeling that way, you're not alone. I've certainly felt that way too. And so that's when I really sit down with people and just, you know, look them eye to eye, if it's in person or over Zoom, and just have a heart to heart and say, hey, listen, the numbers are telling a whole different story of what you could be making. You're really underselling yourself here. And I would say about 90% of people are underselling themselves in negotiations. Again, there's no data behind that, but just based off of meeting every single day with folks who are negotiating with startups to big companies, they're coming in so low. And when I get someone who is saying, yeah, you know, I'm actually going to ask for more than I ever have, I'm like clapping. I'm so excited for them because they're going to anchor responsibly in their negotiation, and they're going to get a higher salary too, because they're building trust, like what we're talking about today. And then they're making the ask. And so I want to talk now about how to engineer value, how to create value. There are times where if someone's in procurement listening, or someone's in sales, or maybe they're running a business, where it's like, I have nowhere to turn. I'm completely stuck. This person is frustrating me. I don't want to negotiate with them. They're a narcissist. How do you create value in intense situations?
Yeah, that's a wonderful question, Shane. I think we've all been there, right? Where we're sitting with somebody where we're thinking, oh my God, you know, I have to do this, but I hate every moment of it. And that happens. I have to say one thing. I can't do magic. So all the tools that I'm offering, you know, if we're sitting with somebody who don't want to do it, don't see the benefit, don't have an interest, it doesn't work. You know, you need to be sitting with somebody who's willing to collaborate. So what I'm preaching, what I believe in, is collaboration that I call smartnership. That is what I truly believe in. But what I'm also talking about in the book is what I call the strategy assessment metrics model, the SAM model, which is a very simple quadrant that basically illustrate how important the counterpart might be for you and how important you might be for the counterpart, right? So it's like a simple quadrant like that. And if you are very important to the counterpart and the counterpart is very important for you, you are ending up in the top right corner. And the strategy you have to utilize up there is smartership. Not using smartership up there is, and I'm sorry to be very direct, but that is directly unintelligent. On the other hand, if you're down to the left in the bottom, where you're not important to the counterpart and the counterpart is not important to you, feel free, go crazy in zero sum negotiation, because that might be a commodity market with hundreds of suppliers and hundreds of buyers and a lot of different options. So you may not need to invest time in long-term collaboration and utilizing value and what have you. The reason I'm just starting off by saying that, Shane, is because we have to obviously be clear when and how and if we want to work with macroeconomics. And obviously, I know it sounds like a new word, negotiation economics, but if you Google it, you can find lots of free information about it. And if you feel that you want to buy the book, it's explained in detail with lots and lots of examples. But macroeconomics is really just trying to identify and capitalize that hidden value I keep talking about that is out there. And a hidden value, just to give you a very simple example, is the difference between your cost and my value, or my cost and your value. So Shane, for instance, let's say you and I are sitting in a negotiation and we are talking about delivery. You might be the supplier and I might coming to you as a strong buyer and say, Shane, I expect you to deliver. And I expect you to deliver in 2 weeks, right? And I'm just saying that because this is just a statement. That's just what I want. What we are missing quite often in negotiation is actually getting behind the claim and figuring out what is your cost of doing delivery. Now, let's assume that your cost of handling that delivery is $50,000, but my cost of going to pick it up instead of having you delivery making that delivery would only be 20,000, then it wouldn't, from a mathematical point of view, make sense that you should be in charge of delivery because your cost is higher than my cost. So instead, the numbers are wonderful because they always tell the truth. Instead, we should figure out I have a lower cost. So obviously, I should go and pick it up. I'll have a cost of 20,000. You will compensate me for those 20,000. And the difference between your cost of 50 and my cost of 20, that's 30,000, that is necroeconomics. And we have to negotiate about splitting that somehow. Those 30,000 are the up to 42% that I keep talking about is being unrealized and left on the table in many negotiations. And, you know, I'm just talking about delivery. It could be terms of payment. It could be warranty. It could be warehousing. It could be education. We have hundreds and hundreds of variables where we have that asymmetric value. And what is interesting to me, Shane, is that many of our esteemed colleagues out there are not really focusing so much on the value itself. And you said earlier that one of my specialties is trust. And that's true. But it's trust based on the fact that trust is required to make that financial benefit coming out of a negotiation. And it's actually so simple. I was sitting with a client here in Stockholm, and it's not rocket science. Necroeconomics is definitely not rocket science, but they had not at any point been utilizing it, embracing it, capitalizing it. And after just a two-hour session with the head of that organization, they walked out and thinking, we have fortunes lying here. It's just a question about bending down and picking it up. And then obviously changing your mindset on what negotiation is all about.
Yeah. Yeah. It's mindset is huge. I think that's another thing that is often missed too, because the tactics are what sell, what to say sort of sells. But what's really crucial is that mindset that you're talking about, Keld. It's, and the 42% of value being left on the table. I remember you flashing that in the presentation in front of the audience. I remember it's a big 42, if I recall, on the slide, and everyone's kind of taken back and curious about this. And it's powerful. It's powerful. And that may change. I feel like it depends on the negotiation. Every negotiation has its complexities and is different in a sense. So we talked about the rules of the game. We talked about engineering value. We talked about Keld's method. And the reason why we're meeting here today is because Negotiation Essentials comes out October 24th. So Keld is doing lots of interviews, lots of podcasts on this right now. This isn't the only one. And so definitely grab your copy of Negotiation Essentials if you haven't already. I already have as well. And so before we get into the final section where we talk a little bit more about your heart for the book and what's coming up next for you, all these things that we're talking about today, needing a strategy, building trust, negotiating the negotiation, these things are great, but if you don't practice them or if you don't do them, then they won't get better, because negotiation, these skills are perishable. If you don't use them, they go away. It's like a muscle. If you don't work it out, it's gonna atrophy. It's the same thing. And it's something I've experienced too. So even if you're at the grocery store or you're in a low stakes situation, practice some of these things that Keld's talking about. Or even Keld, your company, the Center for Negotiation, is sponsoring the negotiation challenge and you've judged past competitions in the past. So I know that's coming up. So you can join that too. There's so many different opportunities to practice. So no excuses if you're listening. You can always practice. You can always message us too if you get stuck into something. And so, Keld, you wrote this book because you want the world to rethink what negotiation is. Now, let's rewind a bit and let's talk about you. You have led a publicly traded company as CEO, and you've done lots of different jobs in your life. You have a family, you're constantly traveling. What is energizing you? What is motivating you right now to do and take on all of these things?
That's a good question, actually. Just before I dive into that part, we're live on LinkedIn and YouTube, and obviously it is recorded so people can watch it or rewatch it. And you do have the opportunity of making comments or questions. Chapelita, my assistant, is sitting out there ready to take it, both for Shane and I, by the way. So just write, if you're on LinkedIn, just write on the comment in LinkedIn, and we actually can see it here on StreamYard where we are broadcasting from. Yeah, back to the question, Shane. What is the motivating for me? Well, let me take a step back, a big step back. I was heading a technology company actually here in Stockholm back in the 90s, and it was a public company. And the fun thing is that when you're a CEO, you, and I'm generalizing, but most CEO believes that they are naturally born great negotiators. And so did I. I was no different and no better than anybody else. And what happened back then was that my former partner, who's unfortunately is not among us anymore, a Swede who founded the concept that we have developed since then, back in 1976, came to me because we hired him as a negotiation coach and advisor. And I'm not exaggerating my story, Shane. In 120 minutes, he moved me from being unconsciously incompetent in negotiation to being consciously incompetent, because I suddenly realized that I had no clue on how to negotiate. And that was such inspiration for me, because I realized that that was not only me. That was actually the majority of people out there, because a lot of people have learned to negotiate by watching colleagues doing it. So, and I'm sure you do the same, Shane. I'm meeting people that come to me and says, I appreciate what you're doing, but I have no need because I have 23 years of experience in negotiation. And perhaps they do. But in some cases, I find that they have 1 year of experience. They just repeat it 23 times. And, you know, that's not really 23 years of experience. I can only, I'm just jumping. I'm sorry, Shane, but I can only concur and emphasize what Shane just said. Negotiation competition is something that is up and coming. And our mutual friend, Remy, he is running one international. What's the correct name, Shane?
It's called the Negotiation Challenge, and I've done it twice. It's awesome.
Okay, right. I would invite everybody to join a negotiation competition. And the one that Remy is running looks really great. And as Shane is saying, we can only endorse that and promote that. And I've been judging several international negotiation competition, the oldest one and another one organized by APIT in Asia. And it's a wonderful opportunity to test yourself and train, because I can't agree more, Shane, that one thing is reading a book, you know, reading a book about negotiation, that might be a cool thing. But I often use the term, you can't learn to swim by reading a book. And what I mean by that is that you can read all the books in the world and you feel that you've learned something, but then you get out there and have to practice it. And that's a very different story. And that is so important about negotiation. So either join a workshop, it doesn't have to be mine or Shane's, but somebody join a workshop, practice it, or join our negotiation competition. That is really essential. Anyway, back to my story. So that was really what happened, to be exact, in 1998. And I realized, right, that that's a mission. And it came to me as a mission. It was not even just a career or a job. It was a mission, because I realized that you and I and everybody as human beings, we can improve our negotiation so, so much. And why is it important? Well, it's important because 80% of our communication is negotiation. We negotiate with our spouse, with our kids, with our suppliers, with our clients, with our managers, with our bank, with our travel agency, with the tax authorities, you name it. We negotiate all the time. And the majority of us have no, and I apologize for my language, freaking clue on how to do it correctly. Because it's not part of elementary school, it's not part of high school, and a lot of universities don't even have it on the schedule. So you have so many professionals out there who don't have a clue on how to do it properly. They might have read a book about it. They might have read two books about it. It's not enough. You have to train it. You have to practice it. You have to do more. So anyway, Shane, that's a long story. That was why I got into it. So what happened was I decided right at that moment that I was not going to continue my life within technology. I changed my career immediately and went into what I'm doing today, which is really all about helping organizations and individuals trying to change their mindset and understand why this topic is so important. So just to finish up, I am so happy to support everybody in this world who have a positive mission about raising the awareness of negotiation. And this is, it's a journey, you know, it's a marathon, it's not a sprint, because you don't change something overnight. And I'm happy to report that the awareness of the importance of negotiation is increasing every single day. But when I started in 1998, negotiation was a soft skills that was out there to the left somewhere. And if you had the time, you would buy a training course and then you would do something on that. Today, I'm happy to report that I see C-suites level at multiple organizations acknowledging the importance of negotiation. And you know what, Shane? I was so happy. It was only earlier this year when McKinsey & Company came up with a study where they've been interviewing the Fortune 500 C-suites in the U.S. And you probably know of the study as well. And what they found was that 93%, I repeat, 93% of all the CEOs of the Fortune 500, the 500 biggest organization in the U.S., thought that the concept of implementing a chief negotiation officer was of interest, and they would do that within the next 3 years. And even more importantly, 96% of the 93% felt that focusing on negotiation skill could increase the earnings by at least 5%. I think this is the point where the microphone drops, right? It just re-emphasizes how important negotiation really is.
Yeah, it's true. It's a really, really interesting study. And it's awesome to see that the importance, the awareness of it is growing. And I feel like we're just in the early days, but there's so much opportunity and possibilities for people to learn these skills. And it's really, really neat what you're doing with your strategy and how you're rallying people to learn and to grow. And sometimes some people learn negotiation out of a need, out of a pain. Maybe someone said something that's hurt them and they need to learn how to navigate out of the conflict. These skills help that, you know? So I'm so glad, Dwayne, Rick, Krista, so great to see you. And thanks for the kind words about the conversation of today. Yeah, it was a great, great, great discussion. Keld, tell us about the future of negotiation. And we actually, you know what? We've got Jim who just came in. Do you feel negotiation should be taught at the... Yeah, so let's talk about where negotiation is being taught. And so you've taught negotiation, Keld, at universities. At American University, where I'm at now, they have a course and a professor who focuses only on negotiation. So could you speak to that, Keld? A question from Jim is, do you feel negotiation should be taught at the collegiate level regardless of study?
Well, yes. The short answer is yes. I even think it should be implemented in elementary school. I have two sons who's 4 and 7, and I'm actually not really spending time on trying to train them in negotiation, but I should. And obviously, we should not necessarily call it negotiation with kids in elementary, but they could start learning the tools on how do you deal with conflicts, how do you deal with disagreement, how do you work together to get a better result? Because, having two boys, it's definitely interesting because they're constantly fighting about toys and who should do what and blah, blah, blah. So, that's the negotiation as well. So you can't start too early learning tools on how to handle disagreement or how to achieve agreement. I think that's really essential. I had a fun experience, Shane, I want to share with you. I was invited to lecture at an executive MBA program at a school in Europe. And that was great. I said, thank you so much for your interest. And then I said, the group, the students here, who are all in their 40s, early 50s, is that a required program, the module that you asked me to do? And they said, no, it's elective. And I said, why is it an elective module? And they said, because they're all very experienced and skilled, expensive. And then I said, and they said, so they all know how to negotiate. And I said, why? And then it was all quiet. And that again is the misunderstanding I've been talking about. We really think that we can do it just because we've been doing it for a long time. And that may not necessarily be the answer. So back to Jim's question, I feel that yes, it should be a required module in all colleges. It should even be a required skill that we build into basic training in whatever we do. It's something that we just need. So that's really essential. And what we talked about earlier, Shane, as well, is not only a question about reading a book, it's a question about trying it out.
Yeah, it's about putting it out there. It's about practicing. Feel free, as Keld mentioned, drop any questions that you have for Keld in the comments. His book comes out October 24th, which is less than a month away. So it is called Negotiation Essentials. So you got to check that out. Keld, I don't see any other questions coming in, but I do have one question for you that I like to ask. How much of your negotiation skills for you personally were you born with, and how much of those skills have you earned?
Oh, sorry, I lost you there. I apologize. I might have a bad internet connection here at the airport. Could you repeat that, Shane?
Yeah. Hey, you sound good on my end now. How much of your negotiation skills have you? How much of your negotiation skills have you earned, and how much of your negotiation skills were you born with?
That's a wonderful question. I don't think I ever got that question before, Shane. That's a great question. I think that you're born with genetics. You're born with a personality, and that personality could be carried into your ability to negotiate. I don't think you as such are born with a natural behavior around negotiation. I'm normally talking about that in order to be a good negotiator. I actually just got that question the other day. What is a great negotiator? And I was sitting there thinking for a moment, because obviously I've been trying to list all the criteria, but curiosity is one. Ability to listen is one. Showing empathy is one. Asking question is one. Being generous, as we talked about earlier, is one. And the list goes on and on and on. So I would say if you're born with traits where you are good at listening, picking up information, having empathy, being curious, that's something you could be born with. That is tool that is really relevant to negotiate. But that's, I would call that a personality trait, really. And then you can add the techniques that are required to use that effectively in negotiation. But I love the question, Shane, because it's really a debate, right? I meet some people sometimes that says, well, she or he is a born negotiator. And I'm often thinking, I don't believe in that. I don't believe anybody is born to negotiate. I certainly wasn't. I was a terrible negotiator. But I have to realize that it was a terrible negotiator. And I think sometimes some people think they might be good at something, but in reality, they are not.
Yeah. Yeah, it's true. It's true. Well, Keld, we've talked about your book today quite a bit. It's called Negotiation Essentials. If you just joined us towards the end of today's show, Keld, you also have a newsletter with a couple thousand subscribers. So if people want tips, they can subscribe to your newsletter. Where else can you help people? Where else would you want them to go?
Well, I am the negotiation expert at World Commerce and Contracting, which is an international nonprofit organization with about 70,000 members globally. It's an international organization that is focused on contracting, obviously. But they have, their members are typically in procurement, in legal, in sales, and in everybody around negotiation, really. And I can only emphasize and promote that organization because they're really trying to promote the idea of negotiation as well. And an annual membership there costs really nothing. They have the Americas conference in Dallas in a couple of weeks where I'm going to speak. It's a 2-day conference. They have a European conference. They have an online one. They actually just had a whole contracting week where we talked about contracting and AI for the whole week, because AI and negotiation is the big thing right now. I'm sure you are getting that, Shane, as well. You're probably being invited left and right to talk about ChatGPT and BART and AI and negotiation in general. So that's a big thing. And we talked about that the whole week with the World Commerce and Contracting. Besides that, we have an online university, smartnershipclass.com, where you can take self-paced training or hybrid training on whole concepts. You can also get training from WorldCC, obviously. I'm a professor at BMI, Executive Education, which is an accredited university in the Baltics, where you can do training on negotiation. I'm a professor at Aalborg University in Denmark, where you can conduct or run their MBA training and online training as well, by the way. And I'm a professor in the US at a university where you can run training as well. And then in my own company, we run workshops, both virtually and live, where you can join. And I just want to say one thing, Shane, just back to what we talked about earlier. I often meet people especially these days when I'm out promoting the book. I'm especially journalists saying, so why should we buy, why should the reader buy and read only your book? And I'm saying, well, they shouldn't. They should not buy and read my book on negotiation. They should read and buy my book, hopefully, and then 2-3 other books on negotiation from different authors. Because my book is certainly not containing everything that is important about negotiation. That's impossible. And nobody else is doing the same thing. Nobody can cover this enormous topic in one book. So if you have bought one book on negotiation and sitting there thinking, I know everything about negotiation, you are so wrong. You have only dived into the top of the iceberg. You need to study different authors, different directions, and different books. Because we also have different directions, a different way of thinking what negotiation is. And Shane, I know you participated in a bunch of workshops, and I applaud you for doing that. That's a real true investment in becoming a better negotiator. And I would say the same. It's not enough that you join one of our workshops. You have to join our colleagues' workshops as well if you want to be if you really want to improve the way that you do negotiate, you have to join different programs. So I'm not sitting here just to promote my own book and my workshops. I'm promoting the general idea about becoming a better negotiator.
Yeah, of course. Like you said, application, applying it, it's powerful. And Carla, a couple of folks have asked about where to get the book. I dropped the link in the chat. It's on Amazon. If you type in Negotiation Essentials, you can pre-order it. Kelds, I'll leave it to you. Any final words, last questions that you want to ask me, or anything that you want to cover that we haven't already covered? I feel like we did a full gamut of the whole book.
Yes. Thank you so much, Shane. I really appreciate it. I think it was a wonderful talk today. I have a question for you, Shane, especially since you have participated in so many different programs. What's your takeaway from joining one program compared to the other program compared to the third program? Would you agree with what I just said, that you pick something up that is different for one program compared to the other?
Yeah, of course. The three that come to mind is, one, I learned to negotiate years and years ago at a suicide hotline. So I learned how to de-escalate conflicts there, intense situations. Then I did the Black Swan training with Voss, where I learned how to ask questions, how to demonstrate empathy. And then I attended yours, where I learned how to build trust, how to build a strategy. All those three things are different components that make up a negotiation.
Right, exactly. Yeah. So how would you feel if you've only, it's kind of a dumb question asking you, because you've done so much within negotiation. I know you've done a lot of self-study as well, but how do you think, if you should think back, if you only joined one of these programs, would you probably, like most people do, feel that I'm 100%, I know everything? Or would you at this point in your life be sitting there thinking, I'm missing something?
Well, you know, they say you're either learning or you're dying. And so... So you have to continue to push yourself. I think that that's maybe one reason why I love running so much. And it doesn't have to be running. It can be chess for you. It can be a different hobby. But I love running because running is a constant negotiation going on in your mind. Like, do I want to stop or do I want to keep going? And so negotiation stretches beyond the boardroom. Negotiation stretches into, do I want to study today or not? When I know that I need to, do I want to have that conversation with that colleague that I've, you know, been putting off for a couple weeks that needs to be had? That's a negotiation too. So it stretches beyond the four things that we talked about today. But yeah, it'd be tough to pick just one.
Sure, I fully understand. What would you recommend our audience to do if they want to improve their ability and skills in negotiation?
Yeah, I mean, if they're in sales or procurement, or they're running a business, there are so many different resources. I did the Harvard program on negotiation, which is really fascinating as well. That's a week long, it's virtual and in person. It's a great way to build your network too. But really, if I had one thing, I would do a competition. I would do it because that is how you learn. You get practice, you get judged, which is a bit, you know, intimidating at first. But I did a competition before your training and I finished in the bottom, and I did a competition after your training and finished towards the top. So it's like a combination of it's a combination of doing things, but if I had to recommend one thing, I would just say, go negotiate, go practice, go do a competition, and go connect with people who are different than you, because that's really where my fuel for learning negotiation comes from. It comes less from negotiation and more from just loving people.
Yeah. Yeah. That makes absolutely sense. Wonderful, Shane. Thank you so much for taking time out. I know you have a very busy schedule in DC. I know you are studying yourself, which I really applaud as well. That's a wonderful thing. Just continuing the education. We all need to do that. So thank you so much for your time, Shane. I really appreciate it. Thank you, my friend.
Yeah, of course. And for everyone who tuned in, Rick, Krista, Jim, Dwayne, everyone who's listening, so great to be with you. And Keld, more important, you know, most importantly, today the conversation was about your book and it was fantastic. And I look forward to October 24th. It's coming soon.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.